Going home was simple for Judy Garland in The Wizard of Oz. She just clicked her heels. But a festival honoring Garland in her hometown isn't clicking, and storm clouds may blot out the rainbow in today's Inside Story. Grand Rapids, Minnesota is a small town whose most famous citizen was Judy Garland. When driving into town, you would never know it, because the welcoming sign only mentions that it's home to a paper company. A story in the current issue of Fame magazine says that the town has turned its back on Judy and that certain locals are looking to put an end to an annual festival honoring her memory. Judy Garland was born Frances Gum in Grand Rapids in 1926 and lived in this house. She moved away when she was 4 years old, but when she was asked to return for the town's 50th anniversary in 1941, she didn't show. The town's newspaper publisher says that some folks still remember that.
Some of their feelings were hurt when Judy Garland appeared to be ashamed of her hometown. And they remember that. And the smaller the town, the longer the memories.
The director of the Judy Garland Museum says others did not approve of the way Judy died of an accidental drug overdose.
The way she ended her life, I like to say it wasn't the way that a girl from northern Minnesota should end up that way.
The first festival was held in 1989 and was a huge success. But in 1990, the town flew in a large group of the original Munchkins from The Wizard of Oz, and the festival lost money. Dr. Daniel Kelly resigned from the County Historical Society in protest.
They shipped in all the Munchkins this past time. I think there were 13 or so from all over the country. We ran almost $8,000 in the hole.
But despite the flap surrounding the annual Judy Garland Festival, the majority of the town's 8,000 or so citizens still have a special feeling for her.
We're proud of the fact that she was born here, and we're proud of the opportunity to show our community to people who are interested in Judy Garland.
Well, the town will give the festival one more chance in June in conjunction with Grand Rapids Centennial Celebration, but if it's not a moneymaker, town officials could throw in the towel.
The controversy about Judy Garland continues in a new book about her stint on network television, and Leonard Maltin is here to take us inside the pages of The Rainbow's End. Hi, Leonard.
Hi, Mary. Well, television series, you know, often have a high mortality rate, but there are some shows that have never been forgotten, and one in particular that barely made it through one season, and it's almost 30 years now. What show am I speaking of? Well, the Judy Garland Show, of course. It's a high-water mark in TV history, but a show so troubled behind the scenes that's been the sole subject of two books, one written years ago by Mel Torme, who worked on the series, and a new one that reveals even more of the story behind Judy's memorable time on TV.
I feel a song coming on.
In 1963, Judy Garland signed with CBS to host her own weekly variety TV show. A new book titled Rainbow's End, The Judy Garland Show, is a revealing glimpse into all of the backstage politics and turmoil that engulfed the short-lived but critically acclaimed series. The show's original producer, George Schlatter, wanted to create a series to feature his star in a light not usually seen on television in the early 1960s.
Part of the fascination with Garland was always the flaw, because something would happen and she would laugh or she'd get mixed up. The woman could be a pain in the butt, boy, but when that light went on, she was there for you.
Forget your troubles.
Happy day.
Come on, get happy.
Again.
The Judy Garland Show featured some of the greatest talent in show business history. A 21-year-old Barbara Streisand joined Judy and Ethel Merman. And a young Liza Minnelli showed the world that star power ran in the family.
Wherever we are, it's together.
But some network executives weren't happy with the show's loose, unscripted style. Judy's other daughter, Lorna Luft, remembers that there were even disagreements about the song she wanted to sing.
She wanted to be able to get out there and say, look, here I am. I'm not Dorothy only. And I'm not this person that you grew up with the Andy Hardy movies. And I'm going to introduce new things to you. And CBS probably got scared of that. And they would like her to sing Over the Rainbow three times a week.
Jerry Van Dyke was featured on Judy's show as her comic sidekick. He remembers that the comedy sketches they wrote for her never seemed to click.
They didn't know how to write for her. In fact, you can't write for a talent like Judy Garland. It had to be completely herself, and you can't take someone and put them in a format and have it work. They tried everything.
How I wish I could forget.
The series only lasted one season, and Judy's production company, which produced the program, lost a great deal of money. Rainbow's End author Coyne Stephen Sanders believes that she never recovered from the show's demise.
Well, Judy was 41 when she signed to do the series, and when she did, she was at the top of her career. And she signed for the series really primarily for financial security, which she had never had before. And when the series was canceled after only one season, it sort of triggered her professional and personal demise. It affected her health, and it was a blow from which she never really recovered.
But in spite of an early cancellation and a lot of negative publicity, the shows themselves survive as genuine TV classics.
Stars today come and go, but nobody challenges the Garland mystique even today.
I feel a star coming on.
I was just a kid, but I remember watching those shows back then, and they were great, and they're still great. Some of them are coming back, in fact, on the Disney Channel starting next month. And if you can't get enough of Judy Garland, there's another new book out called The Complete Judy Garland by Emily Coleman that's a complete chronicle of everything she ever did in show business. Concerts, and records, movies, the works.
And her Carnegie Hall albums are the best ever.
Unbelievable.
Thanks a lot, Leonard. Good piece. John Goodman exposed in a photographer's lawsuit when we get back.